Tom Tolbert knows about losing basketball. I don't know how else to make this segue, Tom. The Warriors Radio Network analyst, former NBA player. Good morning, Tom. How are you?
Good morning, Dan. I don't know that much about losing basketball. I didn't play that much with you, did I?
No.
No.
Now
no,
you
didn't.
You got me.
Not really.
What's the biggest win of your NBA career? Just to let this audience know the substance of your career.
Do preseason game count?
I got you with nine. You had nine postseason wins, I think.
So trust me, I had no postseason wins. I was present for those postseason wins. I guess when we were a seventh seed, we beat the Spurs with Robinson and Terry Cummings. That was a Rod Strickland, Sean Elliott. That was a really good basketball team. And we took them down, and then we got smacked by the Lakers the next round. But I don't know. I mean, I guess if somebody were to ask me what's my biggest basketball win, it'd be North Carolina when I was at Arizona to get to the Sweet 16. But as far as the NBA goes, I don't really have any, like, memorable postseason victories. So I'm sorry to disappoint.
I was there at that Final Four game when it was Oklahoma and Arizona.
Yeah, that wasn't as pleasant a memory, Dan.
I know, but that was that game was 50-49 at halftime. Does that sound right?
You know, I think that was the finals game. That was the Kansas game that was high octane. Our game was a little lower, still higher scoring, but the thing I remember about that game is just how many pros were on the court at the same time. We had Sean Elliott, Steve Kerr, Anthony Cook, Judd Bushler, myself, Harvey Grant, Stacey King, Mookie Blaylock, and I mean, it was an incredible, incredible game. And they got the better of us, Billy Tubbs. Damn Billy Tubbs.
Mookie Blaylock was great back then.
I used to call him Pearl Jam, to be honest with you, before.
Oh, you, anyway, moving you on. Called him Pearl Jam before.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, but I mean, it sounds good now. I mean, if I said it, no one would. I don't know if anybody would call me on it, but anyway, they don't even care. Hell, they don't even know who the hell I am, let alone what I'm saying.
All right. You've been calling games for a while. You've been there, you know, for Steph Curry's entire career. When Golden State drafted Steph Curry, the local reaction was what?
I mean, I think they liked the pick. And no one knew what was coming. I don't think he knew what was coming. But really good shooter. Just came off an incredible NCAA run. So people knew who he was, had a shooter. And that was about it. Just a solid player, drafted number 7 overall. But no one knew that Minnesota gaffed as bad as they did. We all should have guessed because it's Minnesota after all. And I always say that Minnesota should get some of the Warriors championship hardware because they are responsible for the Warriors being good, as the Warriors are for the Warriors being good. So yeah, good player, maybe an all-star. Something like that, but not one of the all timers.
But if you look at what Golden State has done, that's why I have so much respect for their drafting, because when you took Klay Thompson, I didn't know if he was a big moment guy. I knew he could shoot. Draymond Green, I got to see him play. He just looked like an agitator. I didn't know that he could develop into what he's developed into. I mean, that's the nucleus. I mean, that's the brilliance of what they've been able to do. And I don't know if anybody thought any of those players was going to be a Hall of Famer, maybe let alone an All-Star.
Well, I don't think anybody knew that Klay would be as good a two-way player as he was. I mean, he wasn't known for defense at Washington State. He was a scorer, a shooter. And people thought, well, that's what we're getting. We're getting a shooter. And he could definitely shoot. You're talking about the best shooting backcourt in the history of the NBA. But no one knew he could be an incredible defensive player. Draymond Green, very versatile. No one knew he could be Defensive Player of the Year. And I think with Draymond, the thing with him was he got in shape. A couple of years into the league, he decided, I'm going to make the commitment to get in shape. And then he was able to unlock everything his body could do. Now he can go and, he can do all the things that everybody thought he could do at Michigan State. Because you remember, his body was much different at Michigan State. And he may be one of the smartest basketball players I've ever seen in a basketball court. He just understands what's happening before it happens. Where most players have to react, he's already ahead of the game by a couple seconds, so he sees what's coming. And defensively, he's just brilliant.
I thought it was interesting and telling that people actually thought, hey, Steph Curry could make 16 three-pointers last night. And I went, I don't think so, but it'd be the greatest shooting night of all time. But the fact that people thought that he could do it tells you a whole lot about Steph Curry. What did you think? Yeah. What were your expectations last night?
That he wasn't going to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's 48 points right off the rip. And that's an incredible game when you start talking about, you know, you're probably going to have close to 60 points if you make 16. But it's Steph. So I said, nah, let's give him a 1% chance of doing it. Because 16 three-pointers, now he may do it at some point during his career, but it'll be one of those natural organic things where they're playing a good team. He plays the whole game, and he just gets hot and then keeps it going. I mean, 16 three-pointers on demand is just absurd to go in and think I can just go ahead and drop 16 pointers because I'm Steph. But because he's Steph, you almost had to leave open the possibility of, well, maybe if he makes 4 or 5 in the first quarter, because we've seen him do that before where he's, you know, made 3, 4, 5 in a quarter. Well, then maybe he could do something like that. But yeah, 16 is just ridiculous. To be honest, I'm pretty sure I didn't make 16 three-pointers in my career, let alone in one game.
Yeah, I think Klay Thompson would be the guy that I would look at instead of Steph to make 16 three-pointers. We're talking to Tom Tolbert, the Warriors Radio Network analyst. I got you 29 three-pointers made.
Did I make 29?
I think.
Look at that.
In over 7 years, you made 29 three-pointers.
Firing them up there for a year.
You shot 30%.
Yeah, that's really nothing to be proud of, Dan.
You were kind of a West Coast Larry Bird, weren't you?
What West Coast are we talking about?
Eddie Bird. I'm sorry, not Larry yeah. Bird. Eddie Bird.
Yeah,
Eddie.
I'd hate to disparage an entire region.
How does this Golden State team match up with the Lakers?
Very well. I mean, I think this team matches up well with anybody because they're really good. The funny thing about Golden State is you think of Steph and you think of Klay and you think of the Splash Brothers and firing threes. They're the number one team in the league defensively. So that's when they won back in 2015, I said this team reminds me of that team because of the depth they have, the wing depth they have, and their defensive ability. Back in 2015, they're the number one team in the league defensively and offensively, and this year the number one team defensively. So they're going to match it well with anybody just because of their ability to stretch the court, Steph's ability to distort a defense, and really they can rely, like last night, they didn't have their best stuff offensively, but they can always rely on their defense. Their defense is the backbone of that team.
When is Klay expected back to play?
Probably January, I would think. A couple weeks into January, they want to make sure his stamina is good and that he's able to go, because that's when you get hurt. You go out there and you get tired and you push it a little bit more than you should. So I think they just taking him along, bringing him along slowly. He's playing down in Santa Cruz to practice and kind of get ready, but they don't really need him right now. It's not like, hey, we're kind of slipping, so we need to get him back. No, they're in great position, so they're going to take their time with him. But my guess would be first, second week of January.
Do you have a Michael Jordan story?
Oh, man. I mean, well, I will tell you this. We're in Chicago, and we're playing the Bulls when I was with Orlando. And we ended up beating the Bulls that game. And they actually showed it. My friends always call me, hey, they're showing the old the Bulls game on NBA TV. And it was the one where Shaq had like 29 points, 26 rebounds. And so I think at the end of the first or midway through the first quarter, something like that, he had 12 points and I had 10 points. And I thought, oh, this is going to be good. We're going to go at it here toe to toe. Well, he kind of left me just a little bit. He scored 63 that game. And I couldn't quite keep up with him. But the amazing thing about Jordan is, so you're playing the game. You're not really concentrating on what anybody else is doing. I'm focused on keeping Horace Grant off the boards, making sure I'm taking care of my defensive responsibilities there, and just trying to win a basketball game. But he was so good that at the end of the game, I think he had 63, and it seemed like he had 30. Like, I knew it was hot, and I knew it was scoring. But you look up at the end of the game, and 63 points is an incredible amount of points. But for Jordan, it just didn't seem completely out of the ordinary. And I'll be honest with you, I think he could average 40 in today's game. I really do. You can't hand check anymore, so you get touch fouls. You know, there's nobody there to defend the rim anymore. I mean, back then, there used to be a whole bunch of rim protectors. Now, you know, there's a few rim protectors, but not a lot of rim protectors. I think he would just absolutely destroy NBA defenses right now. And he'd probably end up getting a three-point shot, too, which he really wouldn't need, but need to get one because that's the way everybody plays nowadays. I think people forget sometimes how great this guy was. And to score 35, 38 points a game back then when defenses were physical and they were bigger and they could hand check, it's pretty stunning how good he was.
He scored so many points you forgot how many he scored. I got him at 64.
Oh, was it 64?
Yeah.
Damn. Yeah, see, I never had that problem. It was easy for me to keep track.
You had 14. So he got you by 50. He outscored you by 50.
You know what? That's actually not bad. I feel pretty good about that. I feel pretty good about that. But it's hard to describe. Like, it's pretty cool now to say you played against Bird and Magic and Michael and some of the greatest players to ever play the game. At least with Michael, I didn't have to be as close to him as I did to Bird because I didn't get to hear the smack talking. I actually had to guard Bird, and that was – it was just a disaster. You know, I'll give you a great Bird story. We're at the opening tip, and we're lined up. You know how guys just shake hands. Hey, how you doing? Good to see you, blah, 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 blah. So, you know, me and Molly walk out there, Chris Mullen, and he goes and says hi to Bird. What's up? And I go, say hey, Larry. And he looks at me, and looks back at Chris, and looks at me, and looks back at Chris, and he said, are you really going to guard me with a white guy? And I told him, I said, yeah, I'm just trying to make a living, man. I mean, can you just, you know, easy. Just settle down.
Yeah, but you locked him down, didn't you?
Yep, 33.
Okay. That's not bad. Got his jersey number.
33, and I think he had something like that anyway. You know, you might catch me. I might bay off a point again.
Yeah.
But he had like 10 against Phoenix. He was having a bad road trip. He had like a 14 against Seattle, 10 against Phoenix. And, of course, it didn't really speak much for my defensive abilities. I got to be honest with you. But then nothing really spoke for my defensive abilities.
Keep your head up, all right?
I'm going to try, Dan. That's how I got to ask you real quick. Has anybody ever brought this up? So the show, the DP show, comes through on the caller ID, and as soon as I saw that, I go, whew, it's a good thing my wife didn't see that when I answered. She might have had some questions that I couldn't answer.
Thank you, Tom.
See you, Dan.
Bye. Tom Tolbert, the Warriors Radio Network analyst, former NBA player.